वेलकम टू ऑल पार्टिसिपेंट फ्रॉम द एंटायर नेशन, रादर आई शुड से कि हमारे रीजन के बाहर भी कहीं ना कहीं इसकी पहुंच हो रही है. आई रियली अप्रिशिएट टू ईच वन ऑफ यू एंड आई रियली थैंक्स टू सचिन सिन्हा जी फॉर डिजाइनिंग प्लानिंग ऑन दिस 3 डेज कोर्स वेयर ऑल द ट्रांजेक्शन रिलेटिंग टू फॉरन ट्रांजेक्शन वेद मनी कमिंग फ्रॉम आउट ओवरसीज और गोइंग आउटसाइड इंडिया and 15 CACB, all issues will be addressed in next 3 days. First session will be delivered by CA Parul Agrawal ji. Parul ji, welcome to you on this In Casa channel. And first webinar by you. And मेरी सभी लोगों से गुजारिश रहेगी कि पहले टॉपिक को कवर करेंगे, thereafter if you have any query, kindly post in the chat box. And apart from this, presentation will be mailed circulated through Telegram group. I will share the link of the channel. And apart from this, any other query, any other suggestion, mera number sabhi ke paas hai. You can text me, WhatsApp me for any issue. Now I request Sachin ji to say a few words before hand over to the speaker.
Thank you, Sumit ji. Friend, good evening, friends. Today I have given a very wonderful job. That is, today I am moderating the session and the session of the
yes, Sachin ji, I have muted all the participants.
Okay, sorry. So today's session is very important because it is going to be, we'll go to cover all the transactions related issue when doing online transaction. At the same time, this is a 3-day refresher course, and in all 3 days we'll cover all the transaction, either it's online or offline, not only in relation to income tax but also in relation to FEMA. Because what we feel that nowadays, whenever you are making payment outside India or whenever you are receiving payment in India from outside India, of course the question of FEMA will arise. So how to take care of all those parts also. So that will be guided by the 3-day speaker, and today's speaker is Parul ma'am, and I am very fortunate that today I am moderating the session. And of course I will forward all the questions what I will receive from the participants. And also I have got a wonderful job that I have to introduce Parul ma'am in today's session. So Parul ma'am is a qualified chartered accountant. She qualified in 2004 and she is a managing partner of Parul Mittal and Associates. She has full hand experience in international taxation, and she is doing advisory litigation in international taxation. So now floor is your ma'am. Please.
Yeah, thank you so much Sachin ji, and thank you so much Sumit ji for arranging and doing such a wonderful platform. I think CASA has been doing a great job by holding these super important super special bullet kind of seminars, which are like for 2 hours, so they are not a big drag, and at the same time they are very relevant because they are on a very relevant topic. So today my discussion is relating to, this talk is relating to online transactions. Particularly I'll be talking about online payments which we make outside India, and since we see that we are existing as much in the virtual world as we are existing in the real world, so therefore since the boundaries between virtual and real are fast diminishing, so therefore I think it's very, very relevant that taxation also catches up with the change in economic setup worldwide, and accordingly let's see what's in store in today's session. And I'll be covering both taxation as well as FEMA aspect, because many of these transactions that I'll be discussing today, FEMA is also one of the crucial aspects when we make these online payments and when we cater to these e-commerce operators and all these online platforms. So hopefully today's discussion should be a very interesting one. At least I was finding it very interesting when I was researching on this topic. With this, let's start. So talking about today's session, I think essentially first I'll give you a little bit background about what digital economy is. And as I said earlier, we are living in a digital world, and therefore a digital world, a virtual world which coexists with our real self and our real connects. Very fast, it has taken over our everyday life. And now, and especially after the pandemic, and whilst we are still living the pandemic through, we can see that many a services and many a goods and so many other forms of promotions and advertisement, we increasingly use our digital digital platforms, and we increasingly consume the digital content. So we'll be talking about that shortly, what are the taxation and FEMA implications on that. But right now, let's first understand what this digital economy is that we are talking about, and how the taxation laws worldwide are shaping up, and they are trying to, and how beautiful, you know, the recent amendments have been under the Indian Income Tax Act, which through which we are trying to, nab these. However, I must admit that this the way these digital this digital economy has shaped and it has actually bloomed, I think taxation is still far behind. But there are very few things which human mind cannot imagine, and cannot and very few feats that we cannot achieve. So similar has been the kind of attempt in taxation, that the kind of steps that have been taken worldwide as well as by the Indian government to tax these different aspects and nuances of the digital economy. To start with, I need not talk much about what are the kinds of digital shops that we factor in everyday life. All of us are aware of so many portals, so many content website which are there, so many e-commerce operators which are operating through which they are selling products as well as services. Without getting into the nitty-gritties of that, I think we should talk about how taxation is, taxation laws are shaping up, and how they are trying to tax this digital economy, so to say. So this BEPS committee, I'll not get into too much of the background, because then another long discussion we would start. And I think most of our participants must be aware of the BEPS action plans, and how when in 2013 the BEPS was formed, and in 2015 it panned out a number of action plans, and the first amongst them were BEPS action plan 1. As the name suggests, BEPS means base erosion and profit shifting. And the idea behind forming this BEPS project was to avoid to limit the tax avoidance in a tax jurisdiction, and to limit the profit erosion and the tax base erosion of a particular country. And this importantly, this becomes more important in a digital economy setup, where we do not live in a particular brick and mortar kind of a setup. We do not have actual real shops. We have a lot of digital presence through which the services and the goods are sold. Even advertisement is sold on a very, very large scale. And since the quantum is so huge, it's important to tax these kind of transactions. And it's very important to categorize them well and to tax them appropriately. So it is interesting to know that India is one of the first countries to take note of this digital economy, and has a first mover, first mover kind of a reputation when it comes to introduction of several unilateral taxation, or several unilateral taxes which are being recommended by the BEPS Action Plan 1. So this BEPS Action Plan 1 has essentially has made three recommendations. One is a SEP, which is significant economic presence, which also India is one of the first countries to really introduce it in our finance acts. Then there is a withholding tax on the digital transactions, which also we have, and then the equalization levy, which in 2016, as it is, India introduced in 2016 on online advertisement payments. which is popularly called EL1, and then subsequently in 2020, which is EL2, which I'll be very shortly talking about. So moving on. So today's topic, which is online payments. Now, online payments is a natural byproduct of these e-commerce activities, which is there. And since, as I said, that India has brought about most of the recommendations, India has applied of the BEPS Action Plan 1. When we talk about equalization levy, this has been introduced outside of the Income Tax Act. And there was a rate of 6% that EL1 was made applicable through Finance Act 2016. Subsequently, SEP was introduced in Finance Act 2018. And then the PE attribution rules were also released in March of 2019. Very recently, which is last year, in the finance bill, this SEP was deferred because all of us were going through this COVID, very unique kind of a COVID situation. So therefore, SEP was deferred by inserting explanation 3A. And interestingly, TDS was introduced on e-commerce operators under section 194O, which pertains to the e-commerce participants. These are very, very interesting topics. We'll be touching upon them very shortly. And then there was a and this is it. So this finance bill of 2020 was completely silent on the EL2, which was a surprise when which came with the final Finance Act 2020 through an amendment, and EL2 was introduced. In addition to 194A, EL2 was introduced on e-commerce operators. And during the course of today's discussion, you would see our discussion would actually revolve around these EL1, EL2, not too much on SEP, and you know, EL1, EL2, and the DTA and the interplay of royalty FTS, and in what particular order do we apply it, and whether or not there is an overlap, and many other allied issues. This is a very basic kind of comparison that I have done of this, of the EL1 introduced in 2016, and then 2020 equalization levy, which is also called a digital service tax, which is DST, and then the SEP. SEP is primarily more of a nexus test, which establishes the business connection, or which establishes the nexus between the payment, between the payer and the you know, and the agent. SEP is generally taxed on a net basis. However, both EL1 and EL2 are taxed on a gross basis. So there is a lot of emphasis on gross basis. Why EL1 and EL2 are done on a gross basis? Because I'll tell you, under EL1, the tax levy is actually 6%, which is not too less when we talk about a gross basis taxation. And when we talk about the kind of and the quantum of advertisement revenue that you know, that these e-commerce companies earn, so therefore it's not a very a very small amount. Secondly, in case of EL2, when we say it's a 2% levy, but it is done on a gross basis, it still becomes very pertinent, and it still becomes huge because it is applied, it is imposed on the entire consideration and not only on the margin earned by the e-commerce operator. We'll shortly discuss about that when we go to the definitions under the EL2. Treaty benefits, since these are very, very new concepts and they are unilateral tax amendments by India, treaty amendments are doubtful unless there are suitable changes in the tax treaties itself. As of now, that hasn't been the case. In case of SEP, yeah, treaty benefit is available. Talking about foreign tax credit, again, since it is a unilateral law, if we also have a similar section like section 91 in the country where this where you have to claim the FTC, then yes, FTC could be claimed in that domestic, in that foreign in under the foreign law. I think there's a typo here. Is it in domestic foreign law? So domestic is, we need to delete that. So yeah, FTC can be claimed just in case there is a provision with regard to that in the foreign foreign land. And then FT is available in case of SEP. When we talk about the rate of tax, the rate of tax under EL1 and EL2, they are all special rates of tax. Under EL1, it is 6%. Under EL2, it is either, it is 2%, but there's also a TDS provision under 194O, technically not EL2, but still it's a withholding tax in a very peculiar case. So yeah, technically we cannot say it's a EL2, but yeah, it is part of the same, there's a very small tweak there, which happens, which attracts the withholding tax of 1%. Then in SEP, there is a rate as per the Income Tax Act, because SEP is very much an income tax concept. And EL1 is the obligation is on the payer. We'll see how it is. And then in SEP also, the obligation is on the payer, because as the definition goes under 917. But in case of EL2, the obligation is that of the e-commerce operator who is receiving the income. So this is one of the prime distinction between EL1 and EL2, that the obligation shifts from the payer to the receiver. Is there any problem up till now? Any question in the chat box? Sachinji, any queries?
No, ma'am. So far, there is no query.
Okay. I hope it's quite clear up till now. However, I've
And ma'am, there's one advertisement appearing on your system. So can you please close this advertisement?
I will try. Done?
Yes.
Okay, great. So moving on, let's talk a little bit about Equalization Levy 1, which happened in Finance Act 2016. This is one of the very first amendments which happened in India after the on the basis of the recommendations of WEPS Action Plan 1. This covers specified services, which include online advertisement and any provision for a digital advertising space. So you must have seen that when you go to this Facebook, there are a lot of ads that pop up, and it is generally based on, and there are different semantics that these e-commerce companies apply. There's different formulas on the basis of which, on the basis of your past history of on which websites you went, accordingly, as per matching your interests, they show certain ads. Now, these ads are not free ads. They are being publicized by different companies who are selling those products. And for the purposes of showing those ads, these companies are making payment to Facebook. So even though Facebook is a free portal, but it definitely earns a lot of advertisement revenue on the, and which is one of the basic revenue models of the entire system. It is pretty much like a newspaper. So however, newspaper gives you free information, but their main channel of revenue is the sponsorships or the advertisements that appear on a newspaper. So similar is Facebook. It generally is a communication channel between you and me, and you know, between a community. Between it's a web and it's a network between various people. It's just a communication channel which shares data, videos and photographs and content between the customer, between the people. However, on a Facebook portal, if you have to make an ad and if you run it for a few days along with all the analytics which are available to you, you need to make certain payments. Based on those ads, if the viewer goes and clicks on that ad and then probably buys the product, then it's the next step comes into the picture. So the first step is that you have to make a payment for your ad to appear on Facebook, or for that matter on other websites. Which have created this kind of a platform through which they can charge you for the ad, or they can charge a company for the showing of their ads. Now, this exact transaction earlier, like before 2016, what was happening was these kind of transactions were outside the ambit of the Income Tax Act. And for that matter, in many, many other jurisdictions also, this kind of online advertisement income of these foreign companies was not getting taxed. Why? Because under our Income Tax Act, we have Section 9, and 9, 1, 5, 6, 7, which are there. They generally talk about royalty, FTS, and interest. So this advertisement as such, there's no mention even till now under this provisions of Section 9. And whatever these payments were happening from a domestic company to Facebook, which is a non-resident, they were not getting taxed. And there are a couple of judgments where it was being held that since it is neither royalty nor FTS, and since Facebook or since these kind of online portals, they do not have a PE in India. So therefore, there's no business being carried out in India. So this kind of income would completely go scot-free, and there was no TDS whatsoever applicable on such payments. So therefore, in Finance Act 2016, this EL1 came in, and there are certain exceptions also which were carved out, which said that the non-resident, if they have a PE in India, the concept is same, just like royalty in FTS. You charge a TDS on a gross basis, and then if you happen to have a PE, then royalty FTS is not applicable, and then you charge as per the PGBP rules. So similar are this thing, but this is not a withholding tax. This is an equalization levy, which is a unique kind of a tax, a new kind of a digital tax which was being levied. The income threshold was given that the income where the income threshold does not exceed 1 lakh, equalization levy shall not apply. Equalization levy would only be applicable on a B2B transaction, which is where one business is trying to promote their business on another portal, and therefore it's a B2B and there's no B2C kind of a setup. So I'll tell you an example of a B2C also, as per my understanding. A B2C happens when, for example, I have a blog and I'm writing a blog, and it's a very famous blog, and people happen to put their ads on the blog because they think my viewership is huge and I'm an influencer and I can influence the decision-making of a consumer. So accordingly, maybe if I'm writing a travel blog, some kind of a hotel bookings company wants to put an ad on my website. Now, this kind of arrangement becomes B2C. So therefore, if they give me any sponsorship income, then this equalization levy one should not apply in such a case, because this is not a classic case of B2B. I'm not in the business of writing that content. It's just a B2C kind of a transaction that is happening. The word online was defined. It means a facility or a service or a right or benefit or access that is obtained through the internet or any form of digital or telecommunication network. So this is just the start. A lot of definitions are there in EL2 as well. And the overlap between the two are avoided at the time of introduction of EL2, which we'll shortly talk about. Now, elaborating a little bit more or pondering a little bit more on this section 164F, which is the definition online, this is an illustrative list, so you can refer to it, which says streaming of advertisement on foreign television channels or a tele shopping channel or a big television screen, the ones that we see if we happen to go to McDonald's. There's a prepaid, there's a screen which is there, there's an auto, pre-recorded reel which happens to flash on it, and there are different content along with advertisement that comes up. So that's also falls under the digital content or digital advertisement content. Then there are radio advertisements and advertisements on LED or LCD, which is available on LCDs, which is available on the flights. So probably if you look at this, an advertisement, by the way, is not defined under the Income Tax Act. So we have to apply our own discretion, but the essential factor is B2C. So it should be B2C and not a, essential factor is B2B. It should be a B2B transaction and not a B2C transaction. Now there are two categories, two broad categories of this advertisement, this online advertisement which is there, which is one of them is the core activity, which is the provision of services directly linked to an online advertisement, like creating the content or designing the digital advertisement. And then there are other residuary kind of services which are incidental to the advertising service, like creating the analytics, analyzing those analytics and providing different pie charts and different conclusions on the basis of those analytics and geographical setup. So
36.4, the entire purpose of GSTR 2A has created, and this form has become extremely important in day-to-day.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Please continue.
Yeah, I think there was a background. Okay. Yeah. So taking this EL1 discussion further, this is the standard compliance matrix of equalization levy 1. There were a couple of issues which were raised when it was introduced, like, that this, since the payer has to deduct EL1, so therefore it may so happen that since these payments are made online and Facebook just gives you a number which you have to pay, so they would not take a shorter deduction, and then you cannot avail those services with a shorter deduction, hence you have to go for the grossing up. Now these are practical jitters and practical challenges in that, not actually a challenge, but it's a necessary evil that you have to, which a consumer has to bear the brunt of, because if you see their advertisement standards or terms and conditions are pretty much predefined, and there's very less that a consumer can do about it. So that is one of the, necessary issue that comes along with it. But when it comes to taxes, I think too much of logic or too much of idealism doesn't work. So that is the case here. So and that cannot be a ground for not following through and not being compliant. Now the threshold of 1 lakh really comes in handy there. Talking about the compliance, the payment due date is the 7th of the following month, and there's also a statement of specified services. Similar statement of specified services also needs to be furnished in case of EL2. Then there's also a statement of arithmetical error. So if you would see, many of provisions here, even relating to the compliances, are pretty similar to the TDS provisions that we have. Only that this hasn't been introduced as a TDS, either under provisions of 194 or 195. The consequences of the non-compliances is also quite, quite interesting. One of the thing is that you cannot appeal on the characterization. So the appeal process is not there. It's only there in respect of penalty. But whether or not equalization levy shall apply on the characterization issue, you really do, the consumer really doesn't have too much of a say. So if a false statement is furnished, then there's also an imprisonment which is there for along with fine, which is there. So it is like prosecution provisions are also there in case of EL1. Also, just like a TDS provision, there's a disallowance. So if the EL1 is not deducted, or even after deduction, it is not paid to the government exchequer, then the disallowance of expense would happen. But as in our domestic TDS provisions, there is a subsequent allowance whenever you pay the EL. And this income, which is subject to EL, is excluded from the total income of the foreign co. Since you're already paying a tax of 6%, so it would actually result in a double taxation. So that may be the intent of the legislature. Accordingly, it is excluded from the total income when we talk about the provisions of equalization levy 1. So with this slide, I'm concluding the brief on the EL1 discussion. And from the next slide onwards, I'll be talking about EL2. Up till now, if there are any queries, Sachin, you can take that up.
No, so far there is no query, but a few participants are raising the concern that you are not audible. So I'm not sure because it is audible to me. So may I request Varun ji and Abhay sir, please check your system again that there may be some issue, because
I'll also check at my end. I think the volume is full when I.
So now Abhay sir is saying that you are audible.
Okay.
Okay, and Abhay sir is has a question whether EL1 is still applicable.
Yes. EL1 is pretty. Yes, EL1 is there. It is very much there.
Okay, ma'am.
Because if EL2 was to replace EL1, then it wouldn't be part of the slide. I mean, with such elaborate details, you know, when we are discussing the compliances and the penal provision also, it is very much there, part of the part of our taxation laws, though not the act, but yeah, the larger scheme of things. Now, talking about the much awaited equalization levy 2020, which has opened another Pandora's box of issues, one may say, or has also provided clarity as to what the intent of government is. It's just that it's difficult to arrive there because this EL2 was not introduced through the finance bill. So therefore, generally what happens is that a bill generally an explanation is given why there is a tax imposition that's happening, what is the rationale behind it, and then it is open to discussion before the stakeholders, and then once those stakeholder response comes in, then accordingly the final amended or whatever amendments the government wants to make, accordingly a finance act is rolled out. However, EL2 was a bit of a surprise, and therefore it took some time for the professionals also to really have a grasp of or to really understand the intent of the legislature about EL2, because in the finance bill of 2020 there was no mention of this. There was only a mention on a related topic, though not equalization levy 2, but on a related topic of TDS provisions relating to 194O. But this just came as a surprise in the Finance Act 2020 itself, and there was some clerical mistakes also which happened in the exemption section relating to this, which are later amended. Now they stand amended in the Finance Bill of 2021, which I'm making suitable references wherever required, because on the basis of they heard us, the consultants, on the public forums, and accordingly I believe certain very valid amendments are being brought about, which we will discuss, and we will try through this session to understand that what was the intent of the government and what purpose is the government trying to achieve by bringing about a equalization levy too. I will not get into the topic of constitutional validity and all, you know, that kind of hyper technical and hyper intellectual discussion, because from a very practical point of view, I think as a consultant we should know that now we have a tax and we have to deal with the tax, so we should rather more be concerned about the characterization issues, the compliance issues, as well as making the client understand that what it entails and what the intent of the government is, rather than actually contesting it in the court of law, unless of course it is something which is bit of a completely off the hook kind of a tax levy. So talking about equalization levy 2, this levy is imposed on an e-commerce operator. Now, an e-commerce operator is a non-resident. So the very first thing that one should keep in mind is that here we are talking about a non-resident. Many a people, when this EL2 came, many a queries I received, and I'm sure you must have also received, where people said, oh, I own a website, or oh, I provide opinions to my clients over emails. So am I supposed to does that make me become a e-commerce operator, or am I supposed to deduct this a 2% levy, because again, as I talked earlier, under EL1, the obligation is that of the payer. However, under EL2, the obligation is that of the receiver. So therefore, there was a lot of confusion, and there were many queries coming in from all corners that whether these kind of, or whether everybody, you know, maybe I have a website through which I'm selling my products. So whether I am supposed to really pay this equalization levy too on the payments that I collect from my customers. So which we'll be slowly discussing here. But right now, the important thing to remember in the scheme of things presently is that this EL2 applies on a non-resident. So e-commerce operator means a non-resident who owns, operates, or manages digital or electronic facility or platform for online sale of goods or online provision of services or both. So as you can see, it says, first of all, the entity should be a non-resident, the entity or the individual. So non-resident who owns and operates or manages a digital or a electronic facility or a platform. So therefore, there should be an electronic facility or a platform for provision of online sale of goods or online provision of services. We will shortly talk about what this online sale of goods is and what this online provision of services means. In the very next, if you say there are three bars in this presentation, in the middle bar, definition of e-commerce supply of goods or services, as it was there in the Finance Act 2020, that has been reproduced. And in the third bar, amendment under Finance Act 2021 is there, the explanation which is there, which is the recent amendment which is there, that has been talked about, and we'll discuss both. So as per the Finance Act 2020 definition, an online sale of goods owned by economic operator or online provision of services provided by the e-commerce operator, or online sale of goods or provision of services, or both, facilitated by the e-commerce operator, or any combination of the above entities, of the above activities, shall be covered levy of EL2. So when we say online sale of goods, so there were certain queries raised that can goods really be sold online? Because some of the consultants felt that a transfer of property in a good happens, or the sale gets concluded when the transfer of property in the goods happens. And that essentially doesn't happen by entering into a contract online, because till the time the actual delivery doesn't happen to the buyer, till the time the sale is not concluded. So on that basis, many people interpreted, or many consultants interpreted it this way, that the online sale of goods cannot happen, or since the property only transfers in the goods when the actual physical goods are being delivered, and therefore only the booking of this sale of goods happens online, but since the actual delivery is physical, therefore this should not be the this should be outside the ambit of the provisions of EL2. Now responding to this, in this finance bill of 2021, the amendment which has come, I think there's a typo here. This is the Finance Bill 2021, not the Act. In bar 3, I'm talking about. So what they say is, online sale of goods or provision of service shall include one or more online activities, which are the following: acceptance of the purchase order. So they have, here they have clarified that if there's acceptance of the purchase order, or placing of the purchase order, or payment of consideration, or supply of goods or provision of services partly or wholly. So through this explanation, what they're saying is that even if you're only placing a purchase order online, still this e-commerce supply gets concluded and you fall into the definition of EL2. So this is very, very important thing, because there were all kinds of interpretations that people were making, and accordingly they were saying that online sale of goods cannot happen, or online provision of services also cannot happen, because you cannot per se provide a service online, because there's always certain aspects of that provision of service which are done offline. Let me take an example of a tour operator. In case of a tour operator, maybe there is a website which is a foreign website, and maybe Trivago. I don't know whether Trivago, I think, is the Indian one, but if supposedly it's a foreign website through which I make a booking for a hotel in UK, and I go and stay in UK, and I make a payment physically in UK, in their currency of the land. And since in that entire set of things, the only thing that I'm doing is I'm making an online booking, and these services are not rendered to me online. The services are only rendered when I go to UK, I stay there and I physically make a payment there. And a very small part of that entire transaction I pay to the Trivago, which is the online operator here. So whether or not this will be covered under equalization levy 2, since I said the interpretation was pretty open when this came, but with this finance bill of 2021, all of this, to a large extent, this kind of an interpretation has been put to rest by saying that even if there is a placing of a purchase order, or if there's an acceptance of the purchase order, or if there's a payment of a consideration, in all these scenario, this EL2 shall get triggered, and this e-commerce operator would have provided this e-commerce supply of goods or services. Then facilitation, of course, in case of facilitation, there is no question about it that since the e-commerce operator is facilitating this kind of a transaction, it is clearly covered under the third tranche of this definition, which is there. So facilitation, I think there was no doubt in the facilitation part of it. One of the queries that people would ask that time relating to facilitation services provided by the e-commerce portal or an e-commerce operator was that, let's take an example of Urban Clap. However, Urban Clap is again a domestic one, I believe, the company. But assuming Urban Clap is a non-resident. So in this situation, when Urban Clap, I go to Urban Clap, I book a plumber service. The plumber comes to my house, and he does the services physically, coming to my place, and that is the place where the actual services are rendered. And supposedly, Urban Clap takes 1,000 rupees for me for that those services. Urban Clap keeps 200 rupees and pays the 800 rupees to the plumber. Now, one of the bone of contentions or the point of open discussion was whether or not this equalization levy 2 should be applicable on the margin earned by Urban Clap, which is 200 rupees, or whether it should be on the entire consideration, which is 1,000 rupees. However, even the Finance Act of 2020 was amply clear that EL2 shall be levied on the transaction. Still, people had had their own interpretation, and there was a confusion, or there was lack of clarity as to whether it should be 200 or it should be 1,000. So this was one of the interpretation issue which was there. But later we'll move to the section where they have clarified on this as well, and they have reaffirmed that on the entire consideration, equalization 2 shall be levied. So as we can see, this finance bill of 2021, they have broadened the definition of 164CB by inserting an explanation which says that even a mere placing of order, or even a mere acceptance of a purchase order, or the payment of the consideration, or the supply of goods or provision of services, either partly or fully. So under all these circumstances, the e-commerce supply of service or goods shall be considered to have happened, and it would be concluded that the e-commerce operator has provided such goods and services. Is this slide amply clear to everybody, or should I take more examples?
Ma'am, can you please give a few examples in relation to the item you have mentioned in box number 2?
Yeah, you can ask me like if there was a lack of clarity on what the example.
Yes, the question is since the term mentioned in the act is online sale of goods owned by the e-commerce operator or online provision of services provided by the e-commerce operator. So it means the service provider or the goods seller is into the online business and having a platform. So what if the person who is selling online business but not having a platform? Let's take an example. Suppose there is a chartered accountant in UK, and an Indian person takes the services from that chartered accountant. Of course, that chartered accountant doesn't have any platform, but he is rendering services over mail. Can we say that he has provided the service, that services also fall under this category, because it is not an e-commerce service, but services has been provided online but not through e-commerce?
Yeah, so Sachinji, I think it's very relevant question, and that's when I just started on this slide. I made a mention of this because these were very, very common queries which people raised, or which all of us were confused about when this new levy was brought about last year. So for this, you know, we must first understand the definition of the e-commerce operator. And when we actually go back to the definition of e-commerce operator, first of all, it talks about a non-resident. So in this case, I think in your example, there is a foreign consulting firm which is providing the opinion over email, right? This is what your question is.
Yes.
Because if it is outright, if I'm giving an opinion through an email or through a website, then definitely doesn't get covered, because neither there is an e-commerce operator, neither I am an e-commerce operator, nor I am a non-resident. So therefore, I'm clearly outside the ambit of EL2. But in the example, in the query that you just asked, here, we are talking about a UK or a foreign or a non-resident firm which is providing a service to an Indian client via email or a website. So what we need to revisit is the definition of e-commerce operator, which means a non-resident that owns or operates or manages digital or electronic facility or platform for online sale of goods or online provision of services or both. So in this, neither I believe that you know, just by whatever email it is, either it would be a Gmail or a Yahoo mail. Now again, a Gmail or a Yahoo is just a communication channel. They are not in the business of providing any online provision of service or online provision of goods, right? They are not an e-commerce operator. Now going back to this consultant, this firm, they might be having a website, but they are not operating or managing any digital or electronic facility or a platform for the online sale of goods or provision of services or both. So clearly this firm would be outside the domain of an e-commerce operator, because e-commerce operator, you need not only have a website, which might be a static website where I can go and put my query, and then they will do a lot of research, or they will, whatever past experience they have, they may issue an opinion through an email. But neither this firm nor the email service provider that they use, neither of these, both of them are a e-commerce operator. Since they are, both of them are not an e-commerce operator, therefore to my mind, EL 2 cannot be applicable in this situation. More on this, I will discuss. Yeah, I think there's a query there. Sachinji, am I audible? There's a query there, I believe.
Yes, yes, you are very much audible.
Yeah, I understand.
Very much audible.
Yeah. So, so is there still a query relating to this, or is this clear?
Ma'am, yahan pe ek query aayi hai mere paas WhatsApp group mein. This, he is saying that suppose the person is taking services like booking a ticket for Book My Show, So he is not he's what for he's making the payment. He's making the payment for the cinema or the movie. But what happened at that in this transaction, the Book My Show will get only a few amount, let's say 100 rupees of the total transaction. Assuming the Book My Show is a foreign entity and we are making payment to a non-resident. So in that case, and the total value of the transaction is, let's say, 10,000. So if you deduct 2% on that amount, so whatever the amount is going to the actual service provider or the e-commerce operator, they'll get nothing because whatever they are receiving, they are passing through the passing to the entity who is actually rendering the services.
Yeah. So see, that's what Sachinji. So these are very are anti-avoidance laws, which are, you know, as per the BEPS section plan, they are being introduced. So similar is the case with EL1 also. EL1 also, it may so happen that Facebook might not take the hit and it might just push the hit to the consumer and we need to do a gross up and accordingly made the payment of advertisement. And we might not be able to actually deduct the TDS and make the payment. So in this situation also, the even after the clarification has come, the government is very clear that you have to pay the equalization levy to on the entire consideration, even if you are keeping a margin of like very small, very low margin, like in a 100 bucks ticket, you're only keeping 10 rupees with you. And on that also, you have to pay this 2%. Now, the entire idea of doing this, and mind you, even when you're paying that 90 rupees to the domestic cinema hall, which is providing the actual service of viewing the cinema or whatever. So even on that, you have to deduct 194O, which I'll discuss in the later slide. So there is a double whammy on the e-commerce operator, which is the like Book My Show, assuming it is a non-resident. So this non-resident has to undergo two compliances. One is deduction of 2% of equalization levy to, which is there, and the allied compliances, which is there, like statement of accounts and all that. And the second is deduction of TDS on the payment made to the Indian supplier of actual supplier of service. You have to deduct another 1% when you make that payment. Now, why the government is doing, this kind of equalization levy? To my mind, I think these kind of anti-avoidance law has been introduced in order to curb these non-residents from doing this anti-avoidance tax planning and to encourage them to actually form their permanent establishments in India. Because if you see the carve-outs in both EL1 and EL2, one common factor you will find is that if the non-resident has the permanent establishment in India and they're paying the tax at the rate 40% or whatever it is, then they are not required to either pay EL1 or EL2. So the idea is to tap these companies and to create as many compliances so that firstly, the Indian government has the data pertaining to these. Secondly, there's a compliance burden. And in order to mitigate it, it may so happen that these companies might consider setting up their shop, the actual business on the Indian land, on the Indian soil, and pay the higher rate of income tax, which is 40%. Under the Income Tax Act.
Ma'am, one question.
Was my answer audible to register it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so it was audible to everyone, right?
Assuming.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay. Oh, so, ma'am, one question raised by Mr. Raj. Whether services of CA abroad not to be included in the definition of FDS and straight forwardly be excluded from EL2?
The CA is providing services to?
The foreign CA is providing services to an Indian organization. So sir is saying that whether it was not included in FTS, so if it is in FTS, then there is no question of EL.
So again, see, the thing is that yes, with the clarification that came in our finance bill of 2021, it is amply clear that there is either or provision between royalty FTS and equalization levy too. So there is clearly no overlapping which is there. So either the transaction either there is a royalty or a FTS applicability on a particular transaction, or there is a EL2 applicability only if this if this provision of services happens through a e-commerce operator. So I believe if your foreign consulting firm does not fall under the definition of an e-commerce operator, then EL2 might as well shall not apply, only by virtue of the fact that the services are being provided by a non-resident. So if they're not operating or managing any electronic facility, there is no network of, or there's no web of, web of different services or different platforms which are there. If there is no such online platform through which they are providing any services, EL2 shall not apply. So is it clear? So generally how these e-commerce operators, how they operate is that they provide you a platform which is based on a different, an array of infrastructure, which is a network of computers, television channels, or any other internet-based application, which is used in a very automated manner, such as a web page or an extranet or a mobile, etc. So it is not a straitjacket static website, which more often than not, most of us consultants have. So maybe I have a website through which I may have a callback kind of a tab there where you can post your queries and request a callback. But that essentially does not make me an e-commerce operator, because I am not deploying many mainframe computers, or I am not having a huge server space on the basis of which my website is operating. And my website is clearly not based on a network of many computers and a network of different infrastructure. So therefore, I am not a e-commerce operator in that case. So therefore, if a UK or a non-resident firm is providing any services to the Indian client, but they do not fall in the definition of e-commerce operator, clearly EL2 shall not apply. So Sachinji?
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Yeah. Is it clear, or any? Am I able to provide some insight into this, or
No, it's okay, ma'am.
Gather more evidence. Yeah. So, you think that we should gather more evidence in support of this interpretation?
Ma'am, एक और question आया है. What if the person takes the consultancy over phone from a non-resident person?
The phone is clearly out of question. Phone is clearly out of question because there is no platform on a phone. Because I'll tell you, today we are living in a scenario where even on a WhatsApp you can give an opinion. Like I can actually type an opinion, take a printout, scan it, and scan it also through a CAM scanner and send it to you over WhatsApp. So clearly, WhatsApp is not an e-commerce operator, and therefore they shouldn't be a EL2. Similarly, in case of a phone. If on a phone, because these are only communication channels, they are not platforms which are selling, which are meant for the purpose of. So WhatsApp per se is just a communication channel. It is not providing any online service, or the basis of this facility is not provision of any service or a sale of goods. However, people are doing all sort of such things online. On WhatsApp also, you have different groups where people are selling all types of products, but still it essentially doesn't make them a e-commerce operator. So every platform is not the e-commerce operator. Let's take another example. Like if we do a Zoom call, like today we're doing a Zoom call. You ask me a query and I give you an answer, and you can tomorrow type an opinion and issue it to your client. And I may say, okay, Sachinji, kindly pay me because I gave you an opinion, kindly pay me. And you make a payment. And assuming I'm sitting in US and I'm a non-resident. So even on a Zoom call, if this happens, then since Zoom is just a webinar hosting website or an app, it doesn't, the purpose of this Zoom app is not an online sale of goods or online sale of services. And accordingly, this EL2 should not be applicable on a, on an advice that I gave you over Zoom, over the Zoom call or over a WhatsApp or a phone. And accordingly, to my mind, EL2 should not apply.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah, so any further query?
No, ma'am.
Yeah, however, a contrary view is welcome. I mean, if we can, and if there is a need for more, more in-depth analysis into it, I think it's more than welcome. So moving further, so this chargeability, I think we already know 2%. Till now, in so many examples, we have discussed that. Now, this ESS should be provided to an Indian resident. That also we are quite clear. Or the person who buys goods or services or both using internet protocol address located in India, or a non-resident in specified circumstances. Now, this is important because here many people get confused sometimes. I think somebody is writing on my screen. I think, please don't write on my screen. Yeah. If possible, kindly erase. I think there are a couple of red lines which are there on my screen. Please try and erase. Whosoever has put this, I think mistakenly, I'm sure you might have. Yeah. Okay. Okay, I think there's another blue one. Soon enough, there'll be a rainbow on this slide. Okay, great. So this will be a remembered slide. Okay. So moving forward, here, what EL2, up till now, what we have discussed is, that there should be a non-resident and non-resident e-commerce operator, which is providing services to a resident in India. What happens in a little bit of a flip case where these services are provided to another non-residents? So does equalization levy 2 apply? The answer is no. However, there is an exception here. In certain specified circumstances, it shall apply. For instance, these specified services, specified circumstances are defined in section 165A clause A3 clause A, which says sale of advertisement which targets a customer who is resident in India or a customer who accesses the advertisement through internet protocol address located in India, or sale of data collected from a person who is resident in India or from a person who uses internet protocol address located in India. So, accordingly, even a provision of service or a sale of goods between two non-residents, if one of the non-resident happens to be e-commerce operator who's providing those services or who's providing those goods, shall be covered under the category of EL2 if this specified circumstances are applicable in that situation. The first one is the advertisement which is there, which are being flashed to the customer in India. And the second is where the data is collected, or the Indian resident data. So this tranche of it covers the, when we say there is a data sale which is happening. So we are complaining that, oh, we live in a world where there's no privacy, whatever we do, is being traced, somebody is tracking our each action that we do online, and sometimes which we are doing offline also. Because here's the news. Do you know that if the Siri is on and we are making a conversation, two people are doing that, and they talk about any of their interests, even that communication is registered somewhere and analytics are applied on it, and basis which our next search you will start to see similar kind of ads. So if you're talking about buying a furniture for your next office, then don't be surprised if you next time go to Google and the first ad pop out that comes is from an Urban Ladder or some other place. Because here what happened was that whatever data was collated, it is being analyzed. Those analytics are being shared with the companies which are advertising on the Google platform. And accordingly, those pop up of those advertisements come and appear on our screen whenever next we visit our screen. So this entire chain of events, now with this this entire chain of events is an attempt has been made to capture it in this equalization levy by saying when there is a NR to NR provision of service. So for instance, let's see the provision of services, just sharing of data. The data has been shared, it has been analyzed, worked upon and shared with the another non-resident. Then this then EL2 shall be applicable in a NR to NR transaction also if the data pertains to the Indian customer or where the Indian IP address, the data pertains to the customer whose IP address is Indian. So for instance, I may be sitting in US or I may be traveling in US, but I'm an Indian resident. So if my data is shared from a non-resident to maybe Google, and then Google uses that data, then this transaction between two NRs shall also be subject to equalization levy too. However, there is a question mark here that how do you tap these kind of transactions? So now the act is silent on this. So just as this data is being transferred, data is being sold. So I think government might also be having their guards up as to how they will conclude that EL2 shall be applied on such a transaction. But academically speaking, yes, there are two situations where even a transaction of ESS between two non-residents shall be subject to equalization levy too. So Sachinji, is this example clear? And to all the participants, or should I re-explain?
Yes, ma'am. One question.
Yeah.
So suppose a non-resident visits India and stayed in Maurice Sheraton and use the Indian internet protocol and book some household item for his home country. So whether that will be covered in this transaction?
No. I'm sorry. I think the previous example only, I didn't make this amply clear. So the previous example that I took was that when the data pertaining to the person who uses Indian protocol address is shared. So per se, if the person is using any, public Wi-Fi or any, even a Wi-Fi of a particular public place, that is of no connotation here. The only thing which matters is when that data is being collated by a non-resident company, which happens to be a non-resident e-commerce operator, and it is shared with another non-resident company, only then it gets triggered, EL2 gets triggered. So these are very, very specific circumstances. One is the sale of advertisement, and second is the sale of data collected of the Indian customers. Okay, Indian customers, either Indian customers, or how do you define an Indian customer? If the person is having Indian IP address. So for example, I have a Gmail account, and there is a data, my email is my data. And similarly, there are some set of chartered accountant whose email IDs are there. If this data is being shared by one non-resident to another, or if there is a sale of advertisement between two non-residents and one of them who's providing the service is an e-commerce operator, only then EL2 gets triggered. Only by merely using a facility would not trigger EL2. Yeah, is it clear, Sachinji? Sachinji, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Okay, is this query, is this resolved, or you have anybody has any further question on this one?
I think there is no query. You can move on.
Okay. So exclusion. So these are the typical exclusions of a EL2, which is where the turnover of a e-commerce operator is less than 2 crores in a financial year, then EL2 shall not apply. Where the e-commerce operator is making or providing or facilitating a e-commerce supplier services has a PE in India. This we have already talked about. That the idea is to try to persuade the compliance burden under the equalization levy. And third is that equalization levy, which is EL1, is applicable. So these are the three exclusions. If either of these conditions is satisfied, then EL2, the charge under EL2 shall not apply. And either the equalization levy 1 shall apply, or there'll be no equalization levy too, because the clearly the turnover threshold is not met, or in case the non-resident has a PE in India, in that situation also EL2 shall not apply. Okay, so moving forward, now we're talking about clause B to section 165A3. Now here, you know, this is the budget amendment which has recently happened, and we'll be discussing a few case scenarios here on this. Well, finance bill, this is not act, this is bill. Finance bill 2021 has amended this section, and it clarifies that consideration received or receivable from an e-commerce supplier service shall include consideration for sale of goods, irrespective of whether or not the e-commerce operator owns the goods, and consideration for provision of services, irrespective of whether the service is provided or facilitated by the e-commerce operator. And this shall also be effective from 1st April 2020, which is like retrospectively from the date on which equalization 2 was levied. So this clarification that they have brought about here, they are just merely saying that the scope of EL2 is quite expansive, and whether or not e-commerce operator owns any goods, it shall apply irrespective of that. I don't know why they have brought in this clarification, because there's this kind of a distinction. There is a limitation under the FEMA provisions, not under the Income Tax Act. I think it was amply clear that earlier also, that if you are facilitating any service or any sale of goods, then also you are covered. And if you own the goods and you are selling your own goods, then also you are covered in the equalization levy too. Similar is the case of a service. Even if you are providing the service or if you are facilitating the service, under both situations, you are an e-commerce operator. Let's take an example of the plumber service. So if there's an e-commerce operator, if there is Urban Clap, through which I'm booking a plumber service, then in that situation, whatever services I'm taking, now Urban Clap is not providing me the service. The service has been provided by the plumber who visits my house and does the and provide the services physically at the location. However, even though Urban Clap is only facilitating or arranging, still equalization levy 2 shall be applicable. I think these kind of unique interpretation that we were coming up, all us consultants were coming up with, I think to put a curb on that, the government has clarified this, because we were even saying that the ownership doesn't get transferred because it is not the e-commerce seller who's selling the goods. The goods the ownership is getting transferred from the person who is, like, for example, in the case of Amazon, as we know that Amazon is a marketplace, so even I can set up my shop there and start selling my products online. So for example, if I set up my shop there and I sell and I happen to be a non-resident and I sell maybe coffee mugs on Amazon and I sell to a resident in India, so since the ownership is being transferred from me to the Indian customer, with Amazon only facilitating this entire sale of goods, then few of the consultants, they had a interpretation that EL2 should not apply because the e-commerce operator doesn't own the goods. It is just a marketplace. It is just facilitating the entire transaction. However, now the government has clarified this, that even irrespective of whether or not the e-commerce operator is the owner of the goods, if there is a sale of goods between if there's a sale of goods which is being facilitated by the e-commerce operator, even then equalization levy 2 shall apply. And since this is a clarificatory amendment, this is applicable from 1st April 2020 itself, which is the date of applicability of EL2. So any query up till now?
No, ma'am.
Shall we move?
Yes, please.
Yeah. So the compliance is, so there's a quarterly compliance mechanism which has been prescribed for equalization levy too, which is pretty much like our, TDS, the TDS returns that we have. So this compliance is a quarterly payment. So it is not a monthly payment because as I'm saying, as we're talking, equalization levy too, however, it seems that 2% is a very meager percentage, but the kind of volumes that these e-commerce operators have, it is actually a Herculean task and they might need another, certain set of softwares and mechanics to really figure out the entire quantum of the equalization levy too. So accordingly, the payment situation has been kept quarterly, not monthly. But for the last quarter, which is from January to March, the payment should be done within 31st March, which again, it could be a little bit of a challenge for these e-commerce operator. One, because the volumes are huge. And secondly, doing the entire payment on the last day of like March 31st could pose a challenge. But yes, in this, since the payer is not supposed to deduct, to make any deductions, therefore, the e-commerce operator have to have a computation mechanism and have to have a mode or a procedure through which they do this compliance. Now, a simple interest of 1% for every month or a part of a month is applicable in case of a default. There is also a penalty provision of 100% of equalization levy, and there's a prosecution again involved here if there is a false statement here. If you remember in EL1 also, there's a prosecution of 3 years. So these are, this is just to make these provisions imposive and substantive so that number one is that the compliance happens. And secondly, the taxes are not avoided at any cost. So that is, I think that is the government's intent why they have, put in these put in these anti-avoidance sections in the taxing statute. Now, whether or not these are income tax or GST or the indirect tax, now that is again, there's an ambiguity there. I cannot categorize these in like one category. Then there is an annual filing. Annual filing is there in the case of, there's a statement of account which you have to file, the annual statement which is there in case of EL1 also. Again, here the appeal is only provided, the appeal mechanism is only there in case of penalty. Same is with EL1, which is both of them fall under Chapter 8. So under both EL1 and EL2, there is no appeal mechanism. So whatever characterization the government decides, you have to bear with it. And so there's no appeal remedy for the applicability or the charge of EL in both the situations. Moving forward, yeah, talking about Section 194O. Now this is important to discuss here, though it is not officially an equalization levy. But yes, this is also one of the most common online payments that we witness in our everyday life, because many of us are consumers of the same services and goods, and many of us are also the providers of the same goods and services. First, I'll just read through this slide, and then I'll take a couple of examples to make make us understand that what we are dealing with in Section 194O. So this talks about, Section 194O talks about an e-commerce participant and not an e-commerce operator. So an e-commerce operator is where the equalization levy 2 comes into picture. An e-commerce participant is the one which is a domestic withholding tax provision, which comes into picture when the obligation to pay TDS arises on an e-commerce transaction. First, let us see the definition of e-commerce participant. An e-commerce participant means a person resident in India selling goods or providing services or both, including digital products through digital or electronic facility or payment for electronic commerce. if the TDS is paid by the e-commerce operator under this section, no other TDS provision shall apply except in the case of receipt by an e-commerce operator for hosting advertisements and providing other services not in connection with sale or services provided by the e-commerce participant. So essentially what this means is that, you know, going back to our very first example that we were talking about, and we have discussed several, you know, different interplays of the same situation. Now, what happens when the e-commerce operator is having a website? For example, let's take the case of Amazon. Amazon is an e-commerce operator. Amazon is an e-commerce marketplace. I have set up a shop on Amazon and I'm selling photo frames on Amazon US, and so this e-commerce operator becomes a non-resident, and I am a resident seller on the Amazon US, and I'm catering to and I've supplied certain goods to the Indian customer residing in India. Now I become an e-commerce participant because I am the person resident in India and I'm selling goods or providing services or both, including digital products through digital or electronic facility. So I'm using the digital or economic facility or the platform of Amazon US. Okay, so here the e-commerce operator is Amazon US and I am sitting in India and I'm selling my goods. I'm listing my goods on Amazon US and I'm selling it to a Indian consumer in India. So therefore, in this transaction, I become the e-commerce participant and Amazon US is the e-commerce operator. And since this transaction is covered under the provisions, under the withholding tax provisions of section 194.40, therefore, there is a 1% TDS levy, which shall be charged on the gross amount of whatever sales I do on the on this Amazon US or on the platform of the e-commerce operator. Now, whose obligation is it to pay this charge, this TDS? The obligation is that of the e-commerce operator and not the e-commerce participant. This is very important to see here because again, Amazon US has the obligation to pay this TDS charge and not me, who's an e-commerce participant. So e-commerce operator is a person who owns or operates or manages digital or electronic facility or platform for electronic commerce, and that e-commerce operator has the obligation to pay this, to deposit this TDS amount in the government exchequer. The scope of this section is on the TDS on payment of credits to the account of e-commerce participant. So whatever payments I received as a seller listed on Amazon US, upon such sale of goods, which are being facilitated by the e-commerce operator through its digital or electronic facility or platform, the TDS shall apply. So again, this coverage. Sometimes it may happen that the customer doesn't pay to the e-commerce operator, but it directly pays to me. Okay, what happens in such cases? So the payment made directly by customers to e-commerce operator, this is participant. So payments made directly by customer to e-commerce participant shall be deemed to be credited or paid by the e-commerce operator and hence shall be liable to TDS. So the liability of Amazon USA stands to deduct and deposit withholding tax under section 194.0, even if the customer happens to directly make the payment to me. Then there are certain exclusions here. E-commerce participant being an individual or HUF whose gross amount of sale or service is less than 5 lakhs and has furnished the PAN or Aadhaar to the e-commerce operator. These kind of e-commerce participants are excluded. So in this, in my example, if I happen to make a sale of less than 5 lakh in a year and less than 5 lakhs and I don't submit my PAN or Aadhaar to the Amazon US, then equalization levy, and I have submitted my PAN and Aadhaar, I'm sorry, there's a correction here. If I happen to do a sale of less than 5 lakh in a year with Amazon US, through Amazon US, and I happen to share my PAN and Aadhaar card with Amazon US, then this equalization levy of 1% shall not be, then this TDS of 1% under section 194O shall not apply to the e-commerce operator, because here one, that my sale is less, it is less than 5 lakh, plus I have deposited the PAN and Aadhaar, my PAN and my Aadhaar of my shop to the e-commerce operator. So this is a small little bit of a exclusion which is there. In all other cases where the sale or services is above 5 lakhs, and just in case PAN and Aadhaar is not deposited, then this section 194O, this withholding tax provision, shall be applicable, but it shall not be applicable on the seller per se, on the Indian seller. It will always be applicable on the non-resident e-commerce operator. So is this clear? Yeah, Sachinji, is it clear?
Yes, ma'am. Clear.
Any queries from the participants?
Hello.
Yes, Pankajji has some query. He'll ask his query himself. Yes, Pankajji, please.
Yeah. Hi, Sachin.
Yes, please.
Hi, Parul.
Hi.
Is my voice audible?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So actually, my query is in respect to this equalization levy 2, which you have just explained a bit ago. So in a case wherein we have a ERP or any other customized software which has been integrated between two group entities just to cater to this purchase order, sales order, and invoicing process, and this platform is not available to any third parties. So it is like it has just been integrated between two parties only, and these are the two related entities, because in any big group it is due to voluminous transaction, it is not possible to have this physical type of flow things. Everything has been integrated. So can we say that the foreign entity is an e-commerce operator?
Yeah, thank you, Pankajji. This is a very, very relevant question. In fact, I think I might have skipped to discuss this one if you would have not raised this. But yeah, my sense and my interpretation on this query is that it should not be covered under EL2. The reason being that this is a ERP, which is kind of an inter transaction. So you cannot say that either of the parties or the non-resident who's providing this service or who is designing this ERP for the purpose of provision of any service is an e-commerce operator. Because it's not very long back, but the advent of WhatsApp, it actually happened when there were college students, they were sitting in separate rooms and they just wanted to design a, which we today call a Wi-Fi, but they wanted to actually communicate with small microphones which were not connected through a wire. So they were just experimenting on that, but they were just two students. It was not open to public. It was not there in public domain. It was just for their own personal use, sharing an apartment and staying in different rooms. So similar is your case. In your case, we may safely assume that this is not the case of an e-commerce operator, because the prime intent of an e-commerce operator is to create a ERP or to create an application through which they are either facilitating a sale of good, they are actually selling their goods owned by them, or they are creating a platform from provision of service. So this is the intent. So it is, the intention is to cater to a larger public or a larger audience or a larger customer base, rather than having it for personal consumption. So in your case, since it is an intra-group kind of a transaction, which is between two entities, they could be related, they could be non-related, but it is not open, it is not out there open in the public domain. So my sense is that accordingly, equalization levy 2 should not apply. I mean, any contrary views on this is like also welcome, because this is one aspect of this which hasn't been clarified in the, and we cannot have clarification on all aspects of a particular law. But yeah, this is what my interpretation is, and it's open on the house to discuss and express their views. Yeah, so Pankaj, was your query like answered, or do you have any contrary view, or you know anything, any point you want to make?
I think you have explained it well. So I just have a, like, my thought is that even my view is also that ELH2 should not be applied. But can someone say that because the software which we are using, these are the maybe the customized softwares by ourselves only? Maybe because we have customized it to that level that these not the softwares are not available outside. So these have been developed also maybe. These have been developed also maybe by us or by a foreign entity, and these have been used by us only. So it's not that we have taken some standard software from my foreign entity have taken some standard software and they have deployed it. They may have developed it in-house, or even if they have taken some standard software, but definitely there have been some customization that they have done in order to just to fit to our requirements. So definitely EL2, I think that would not take into account whether these are the customized softwares or these are the standard softwares. So even that, so the intent is not to sell to any third parties or not to sell to a much bigger audience. So it is just between a closely held companies or between the two related entities. So EL2 should not apply, I think.
Yeah, because, you know, I'll just add here, first of all, the connotation software, because when you talk about software, if it is actually an embedded one, then it becomes goods, you know, and if it actually falls under the, and if it is just a limited use of the copyrighted, copyrighted product in it, then, probably one may say that, yes, there is a royalty implication there. So just in case it falls under royalty, as it is, you're out of the ambit of EL2. On the contrary, if that doesn't happen and it happens to be a good and you say, no, this is a sale of good, accordingly, no royalty applicable. Now let us see whether EL2 is applicable or no. Then in that second tranche, when we look at it, then we see whether or not there is an electronic facility. So whether or not there is a platform, whether or not it is available for online sale of goods. So if it is not available to the public domain as an online sale of goods, then how can we say that this is coming from an e-commerce operator, you know? And in the first place, when the definition of e-commerce operator is not being satisfied, then there is no premise basis which we may say EL2 shall apply. I mean, if this is like making any sense, or this is seemingly, I think, a plausible logical view, which we may adopt, because it is just between two of the entities, you know? So for an e-commerce operator, irrespective of whatever revenue you make, whether you make a 1 rupee or 100 crore, it is irrespective, because there is no turnover threshold which is being given apart from 2 crores threshold. But apart from that, let's forget for a while, there is a 2 crore threshold which is there. But even otherwise, if we see, if you're just owning or you're just managing this software, and you consider that it is not a software, it is just a good, but I've created it only for X enterprise, even if that is unrelated to you, irrespective of that, if you're not putting it up on a platform for an online sale of goods, then I think might as well EL2 shall not apply.
Okay.
Yeah, is it convincing, or you have any other point to make?
No, I think it's convincing.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Pankaj.
Thanks. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. Thanks. Moving on. Yeah. So I think we are pretty clear on this withholding tax provisions under Section 194O. Proceeding further. These are certain key considerations. However, the very first one is relating to the effective date, which is the overlapping of EL1 and EL2, which is there. So there was a little typo error. So the first line of this slide is the verbatim of what was there in the Finance Act of 2020. And the from second line onwards, there is an amendment which came about in the Finance Bill of 2021. I'm sorry, everywhere I have written Finance Act 2021. So this is a perpetual typo error, which is like running through all the slides. I don't know. how I'm supposed to make so many same errors on every slide. So this is definitely not a product of a copy paste. I just want to assure you that, but somehow it is some imagination of my mind, because of which I have written Finance Act everywhere rather than Finance Bill of 2021. So yeah, yeah. So when we see this key considerations, one of them is a typo error which stands corrected with this Finance Bill of 2021. The second one is the 1050 exemption. So there is a 1050 exemption which says that there shouldn't be any overlapping between EL1 and EL2. Now, since when earlier this Finance Act 2020 came, then there was no clarity on royalty and FTS. So therefore, people were saying, okay, so even if it's a royalty case, but it's also a EL2 case, then we might as well, pay 2% on gross rather than paying 10% on gross. So why do we even need a treaty or to take a benefit? So let's just pay on 2%. So there was a revenue loss here. So therefore, government took notice of that, and accordingly, they have made an amend to section 10, subsection 50. And accordingly, they are saying it is a either or scenario. So there is either an equalization levy too or a royalty or FTS. They cannot coexist, and the taxpayer doesn't have that choice. Then there's also expansion of definition of a ESS, which is the e-commerce supply of services, which is there under section 1050. Now they have said that this shall be the same meaning as there is of expanded definition under section 164 clause CB, which we have already discussed, that they have not left any room of doubt for anybody to make a distinction between a facilitation and a ownership of goods, or a just the booking of the order, or just the making the except of this, all of that has been taken care, and an amendment has been brought about in section 10, subsection 50. Now there's an interesting example which I want to take up here relating to 1050 itself. This is there. Let's just discuss this. Actually, the thing is that when EL1 came into play, which is the online advertisement equalization levy, when it came there in 2016, then there was a provision that if the customer whose threshold does not exceed 1 lakh, then equalization levy 1 shall not apply. Okay, so this is pretty clear. This is pretty much there in the initial EL1 that has come up and still holds true to the date. Now, let's envisage a situation where EL1 is applicable, where there is a non-resident who is rendering these advertising services online to the customers in India. Okay, now let's divide these categories of these total number of customers into two categories. One is the customer base, which is half of the customer base, which is 1.25 crores worth of services. They are the people who are having this threshold, who are exceeding the threshold of 1 lakh. So therefore, equalization levy 1 is applicable to them. Now there's another set of, customers, which is another half, which is left behind, who are not, who are not exceeding this threshold, who are below the threshold of 1 lakh. Now what will happen? Will this, the second tranche, which is there, will equalization levy 2 shall apply here, because there is a clearly this is a 1.25 crores of revenue which is there of the NR. I think because of the technical in an ideal situation, if this was beyond 2 crores, yes, equalization levy 2 would have been applicable, but just because the threshold here is 1.25 crores, therefore it shall not apply in this particular case, but otherwise it would have been applicable. So by virtue of this example, I'm just trying to explain to you that there is no overlapping of EL1 and EL2, but at the same time, both of them can exist in a single transaction. Now, this is one of the point I wanted to make by discussing this example. In case I'm unable to explain, or in case the intent of this example, you're unable to gauge, then you can ask me to repeat, and I can repeat this example. So is this example clear to everybody, or should I explain more?
No reply, ma'am. I think it is clear to everybody. Oh, sorry. Suparna ma'am is saying, please repeat once more. So please repeat, ma'am.
Yeah, Suparna. Actually, when there is so much of silence around, then this is actually a monologue. So therefore, sometimes it's difficult to decipher, and I'm not actually also catering to a live audience. So generally, it's difficult to gauge as to the expressions of the participants also as to if they have any query or not. But yeah, I'll repeat this example. So first, let me tell you what I'm trying to achieve by discussing this example. Through this example, I am trying to create a case where in a single transaction, we see that both equalization levy 1 and equalization levy 2 are applicable. So that is the intent, because we know that on the basis of section 10 subsection 50, they cannot overlap each other. So definitely it can be either equalization levy 1 or equalization levy 2. So there cannot be overlapping, but they can coexist in a single transaction. So this is the point I'm trying to make with this example. Here, what is happening is that the non-resident is the provider of online advertisement services. Now, as we know, online advertisement services, equalization levy 1 applies, right? But it does not apply where the customers who are availing this service, if their entire threshold of 1 lakh is not met, the service of 1 lakh, if they don't avail, then equalization levy 1 shall not apply. Okay, so in this situation, even though this non-resident is having overall turnover of 2.5 crores, this 2.5 crores is divided in two categories of customers on the basis of the nature of customers. First category is the customers who are exceeding the threshold of 1 lakh. So clearly equalization levy 1 shall apply, because it's an online advertisement service which these Indian customers are availing. Now the second set of customers, the remaining set of customers of 1.25 crores are the ones who do not exceed the threshold of 1 crore. Now, since they do not exceed the threshold of 1 crore, the equalization levy 1 shall not apply, because there is a carve out in the provisions of equalization levy 1, correct? But equalization levy 2 shall also not apply in this situation. Why? Because the threshold of 2 crores is not met, because only a balance of 1.25 crores is there in this second category of customers. However, if we take a flip case where this balance turnover was more than 2 crores, then even equalization levy 2 can be attracted in this case, in the hands of the NR. So this is the example I just wanted to discuss, that both EL1 and EL2 can apply in a single transaction. So now is it clear? Yeah, I'm unable to register any response.
Yes, ma'am. Clear now.
Yeah. So moving on, I think pretty much many examples we did earlier, but still let's see what are the other considerations which are left. Yeah, this one I think we have already discussed in one of the queries asked by Sachinji, which is if there's a facilitator who's keeping only 20 rupees with itself, and the balance 80 is being transferred to the service provider, then whether EL2 shall be applicable on 20 or 100. So the answer is that it will be on entire consideration of 100, because earlier also it was there, but now with the Finance Bill 2021, this clarification is further, it stands further clarified. Then second is whether EL2 shall cover sale of data by NR, which is collected from Indian residents or from person using Indian IP address. What happens in a case where data is collected from Indian residents is analyzed, and based on that analysis, a report is prepared and sold. whether this is a sale of data. So yeah, as I said, I think this example also we discussed when we talked about NR to NR provision of e-commerce services. There we covered two categories. The first category was the provision of online advertisement, and the second category was when there is a sale of data. Now here the sale of data shall be covered even if you, because see, you do not sell raw data. Generally, a non-resident company would be performing certain analytics on it, and those analytic reports shall be shared to the other non-resident. Okay, so even in that situation, since the distinction is not made in the provisions, in the tax provisions, I believe that EL2 shall naturally apply. Now, the third one is that whether EL2 applies on highly digitized products and services only. So my sense is, as per my interpretation, yes, it is applied to highly digitized products and services only. It is not applicable on every kind of email communication or every kind of static, even static websites that we have and we operate on a daily basis. I think most of us, all consultants, would be having our websites, but just because you act on a query raised on a website, I don't think EL2 shall apply there, because there is no online platform, and there is no because we do not fall under the category of e-commerce operator. That's why. Now this hotel example also we have discussed. I think we have discussed one part of it, not the second part of it, which we can quickly take up right now. Please tell me if I'm going too fast, because I'm little bit coming under the pressure of this the time clock which is appearing on my screen. Yeah, but still it doesn't mean that we should, it's better to understand a few concepts, but with the absolute clarity rather than actually running through the slides. So the first one, I think we have already discussed, when the hotel is in the foreign location and it provides services physically to the Indian resident traveling abroad, and the hotel is taking the foreign currency payment outside India. This we have already covered. The second one, which is when the Indian resident books overseas hotel online and goods and services are charged for online when the Indian resident travels outside India. So it may also so happen that I may go to that UK hotel and I may make all the pre-payments from here, because more often than not we see that there are certain packages which are being booked online. If we do a prepayment or the lump sum payment, then we get many discounts and many offers for those packages that have been created by these hotel websites. So if we do that, and if we just go there and stay in the hotel and all the prepayments are done while we are in India only, but we have made all the online payment to the e-commerce operator, then what happens? I think in both the situations, now that the kind of clarification which has come up with the Finance Bill 2021, Equalization Levy 2 shall apply, because ESS has been provided from an e-commerce operator to a resident in India, irrespective of whether I make a physical currency payment to the hotel outside India or I make an online payment here in India to the non-resident e-commerce operator. I don't think it makes any difference. So Equalization Levy 2 shall apply in both the situations. Okay, before moving to the FEMA perspective, for which I think technically we only have 10 minutes, but it's okay. I think the organizers might give me 5-10 minutes extra. So I'm taking the leverage of that. But there's another example which I wanted to discuss in today's session, because since we are in a flow of it, I think it's pretty much relevant that we understand it. What happens, let us take another example. So there is a non-resident, let's take the example of Alibaba. Alibaba is a non-resident wholesaler, and there is an Amazon US. There is Alibaba from China, and there is a Amazon from US. Now, whatever I have to, so Alibaba can only sell their products through Amazon US in India. We are saying, okay, China is banned or whatever, but there is some reason best known to the organizations, these two organizations, but Alibaba cannot directly sell to the Indian customer, and Alibaba can only make a sale to an Indian customer through Amazon US. Let's assume this is the situation. Now, in this case, what happens is that the end user makes a payment of 100 rupees to Amazon US. Now this Amazon US keeps, keeps 2 rupees to with itself and makes a payment of 8 rupees to Alibaba. Now in this situation, what will happen? What will we say that whatever, let me repeat the example. In this situation, Alibaba cannot directly sell to the Indian customer, though both Alibaba China and Amazon US are non-resident, but I can only buy products of Alibaba through the Amazon USA website, I being the Indian consumer. Now, Indian consumer makes a payment of 10K to Amazon. Out of that 10K, Amazon keeps a cut of 2K. So clearly Amazon USA is providing an e-commerce operator facilitator services, which is the marketplace services, and they park the entire, the residual 8K with the Alibaba. Now this is the situation which is there. Now what happens? So what do you think? What is the taxability? Whether this equalization levy 2 shall be applicable here in case of Alibaba? Any answers? Okay, so not without wasting any time, yes, equalization levy 2 shall apply in the hands of Amazon, because Amazon is and on the entire collection of 10K, it shall be applicable. As far as this transaction between Amazon USA and Alibaba China is concerned, equalization levy 2 shall not apply. One, because we have a specific circumstances which are defined under Section 165. Where it clearly says that only in two specified circumstances, NR to NR transactions shall be subject to equalization levy 2, which is one is the provision of online advertisement services, second is the sale of data. And since in this transaction, none of these is happening, so therefore, there will be only one tranche where equalization levy 2 shall be applicable, and that is at the tranche when the customer is making a payment of 10K to Amazon and not beyond that. And as it is also, it would be quite funny if at first on 10K, Amazon is paying equalization levy 2 at the rate of 2%, and then subsequently Alibaba is also paying. So it actually becomes 18K, which is quite an absurd result, which the government, I'm sure, did not mean to do that, did not intend to do that. So therefore, in this example also, there's absolute clarity that on the 10K equalization 2 levy shall apply, but on the subsequent second tranche of the transaction, equalization levy 2 shall not apply, because it is not covered. This NR to NR transaction is not covered under the specified circumstances which are defined under equalization levy 2. I hope this
is a query.
Hello.
Hello.
Abhay sir has some query. Abhay sir, please unmute yourself and ask.
मैम जैसे अमेजोन से आई मैं कोई सामान ऑर्डर करता हूँ तो अगर वो विद इन इंडिया में से प्रोडक्ट डिलीवर होता है तो डज ईवन शुड बी अप्लाई ईएल1
तो ऑनलाइन एडवर्टाइजमेंट पे है ना ईएल1 तो
हुई पर्टिकुलरली ऑनलाइन एडवर्टाइजमेंट ना
या ओनली ऑन ऑनलाइन एडवर्टाइजमेंट व्हिच इज लाइक इफ यू आर
ओके
फॉर एग्जांपल आपका इंस्टाग्राम में कोई एड रन होता है तो इंस्टाग्राम को इफ यू पे एनी पेमेंट then on that EL1 is applicable. EL2,
and if the goods is coming from outside India to me, then EL2 is applicable, huh?
Yes, EL2 is applicable if it is coming outside, from outside India. If it is coming from a seller in India, for example, I am selling on Amazon, I am an Indian e-commerce participant, then Amazon will deduct 1% levy from the payment they make to me. फॉर एग्जाम्पल 100 रुपीज उन्होंने लिए मुझे 80 रुपीज देने हैं तो 80 के ऊपर दे विल डिडक्ट 1% टीडीएस अंडर 194O एंड 100 रुपीज के ऊपर दे विल बी एंटाइटल्ड टू पे द इक्वलाइजेशन लेवी 2. इज इट क्लियर
मैम? या मैम, थैंक यू.
ओके, सो So with this, I conclude the income tax perspective on these online payments. I know it is a little bit confusing, but believe me, if you you know, actually put all these sections together and you know, give a reading and maybe, you know, revisit this presentation, I think much clarity can come. And of course, with the finance bill of 2021, there's a lot of clarity which has you know, which has come up. Now moving to the FEMA perspective on the e-commerce retail trading in India. So I tell you, this is very, very relevant, very, very relevant topic, because this there's so many companies who want to do, like there's a real retail boom, we would say, worldwide. And there's so many companies which are wanting to set up shop in India and would like to open all sorts of retail trading business in India, be it cosmetics, be it apparel, you name it, and they want to do it. Already we know that there is a Flipkart which has sold the sticks to Walmart, and now it is Walmart owned Flipkart, and Amazon India is already huge. So we are all, we are aware about all these you know, recent developments that have happened. But at the same time, all this e-commerce activity which is happening in India, there is a FEMA perspective which we should not ignore, and I think we should be aware about it when we are recommending to our customers, who are generally the startups who want to, who have either started their e-commerce activities or they want to start up the e-commerce activities in India. So bearing that in mind, let's start. So what are the most common business models which are there under the e-commerce? This is very, very important for us to understand, because this is the basic premise basis which we shall apply, you know, we shall apply the FDI provisions. So one is a B2B model. I think I'll take examples more so that there's an ease of understanding, because generally, you know, when we take more definitions, then people get caught up with a few phases or terms in the definition and we then get lost. And especially when we are at the fag end of the entire presentation after bearing through 2 hours, I think it's quite overbearing. So bearing that in mind, I'll just take example, and with those examples, let's understand what a B2B is and what a C2C is. So B2B is when you have a setup like an India Mart or a TradeIndia.com, where you know, I'm a business person and I want to be connected to other business people. So I go to a India Mart, or where there's a distribution or a procurement service which is going on. Then there's a B2C. B2C is when there is a direct sale from a seller and to a buyer without any intermediary being there. That is a B2C. Then there is a C2C model also, which is operating and which is quite popular nowadays, which is that the earlier example that I gave you, a C2C is if I'm a food blogger, I'm writing a blog on food, and then some company approaches me and they want to pay me to add, you know, to actually promote one of their ingredients, which I should add to my recipes and I should promote others to buy, like all the, you know, all these olive oils and all these exotic ingredients of today. More often than not, what happens is that the companies go to these bloggers and influencers and ask them to add to their list of ingredients. And accordingly, a very persuasive case is being created online. So this is a C2C market, that a customer, I am also a consumer and I am recommending to another consumer, please use this product, this is very good, I've used it personally and it is doing wonders to me. So this kind of, you know, very, very organic kind of marketing, this is called a C2C, where a customer is trying to endorse, to make an endorsement to another customer, or is trying to convince another customer to buy. There are a lot many product reviews which happen on YouTube. There are a lot many paid advertisement which happen on a consumer website. All these are example of a C2C. Then there is a B2B2C. Now, what is this? Now, this is actually our Amazons and Jabongs of the world, because here what is happening is Amazon is already an e-commerce operator. They're already a marketplace. They're already in the business of e-commerce. And then I set up my shop there. I'm also a business who is listed on Jabong or who's listed on Amazon. So it is a B2B first and then to C. So I, via Amazon, I'm selling to a consumer. So this becomes B2B2C. However, one need not worry. These are just concepts which we must understand. They are not defined under the FDI policy, but these, it's better to know and understand these before we move any further. So what is the e-commerce entity? Okay, e-commerce entity, as has been defined under the FEMA provisions, is a company which is either a company law, either formed under 1956 law or 2013 law, or which is an office branch or agency which is owned or controlled by a person outside India for conducting e-commerce business. That is what an e-commerce entity is. So these are all Indian entities that we're talking about. And under FEMA provisions, e-commerce activities refer to the activity of buying and selling by a company through the e-commerce platform. So this is pretty basic, all of this that we discussed. Now the important part is this, that what the FDI policy says about this e-commerce business. It says that 100% FDI is allowed in a marketplace model of e-commerce. Now, pretty much there are two kinds of model under e-commerce operations. First is a marketplace model, which is a typical Amazon model. Amazon doesn't sell their own owned goods or their own owned brands. They just provide a marketplace where any where other businesses can open a shop and they can make a sales from there. The second is an inventory-based model, which is actually, we don't have it here as of now. Only the homegrown startups have it because FDI doesn't allow it. The inventory-based model is when the enterprise owns a good and then they're selling it. So they're maintaining huge warehouses where they're keeping all the goods and from there they're selling it. So it is prohibited under the Indian FDI laws because the Indian government doesn't want unnecessary competition and they don't want players like Walmart and others to enter India who will do bulk purchases accordingly, who will give huge discount to the consumer, thereby killing the domestic market. So therefore, inventory-based e-commerce operators, the FDI is not permitted. So it is completely restricted to them. Only 100% FDI is applicable to a marketplace model. Marketplace.
Amazon तो करता है ना इस केस में कि Amazon अपने जैसे warehouses के अंदर purchase करता है seller से bulk में.
नहीं नहीं उसमें भी restrictions हैं and they are actually violations. These are such big companies. They are doing violations on which you get to see so many articles in the newspaper every now and then. But there are restrictions on the inventory rule which I have covered in this slide. पर वो नहीं करते हैं. वो नहीं कर सकते हैं. Because inventory based model allowed okay. ही नहीं. Okay,
ma'am.
So what they do it even through the different subsidiaries also they cannot do it. So through a group company also they cannot do it. So now I'll talk about the inventory restriction rule. So the new rule state that the inventory of a seller will be seen as controlled by a marketplace if the seller purchases more than 25% of its inventory from the marketplace or any of its group firms. So ye jo aapka rule hai, this says ki even agar aap seller hain, even if you are a vendor on Amazon and Amazon aapse more than 25% of its total inventory bhi le raha hai, toh bhi even you cannot sell on Amazon. Are you getting my point? So the thing is inventory ka toh bahut strict rule hai. So you have to actually go by these rules. Wo baat alag hai, hume lagta hai
ki repeat karna hai
because they say Amazon owned brand. Now we don't know when they say Amazon owned brand, then they have their own, it is through their own vendor that they have, or they have created a vendor who is supplying that. Because you generally see an Amazon owned brand which is there, but the inventory rule nevertheless applies there also. So there is this 25% threshold which is there, which you cannot exceed, even if you're doing a bulk buying from one vendor. Then there is a restriction imposed on the companies having a shareholding of e-commerce companies from selling on the online platform. So even aap shareholding bhi nahi hold kar sakte hain in the companies who are selling online. So if you are a vendor, then Amazon can typically not own you or cannot have a ownership in your company. Okay, so that is also restricted because the entire idea of these provisions is that they should not kill the domestic market just by offering more discount because they have very, very deep pockets. Because as it is, they can take care of maintaining the website as well as doing their huge digital marketing campaigns, which are there both online as well as offline. Okay. Last but not the least, none of the products can be sold exclusively on a by a seller. No, not when, or is it a website exclusively launches a new iPad or a new technology product? So,
as an MUP,
so this was a situation where Amazon, there would be products which would be exclusively sold only by Amazon, and none of the other website had the access to do that. Now there is a limitation on that. Now no more you can do a exclusive sale of a particular product. However, the product manufacturers can have their preferred online seller, but there is a difference between a preference and a exclusivity. So ab inke contact exclusive nahi ho sakte hain. So maybe they're selling only on one website, but they cannot use the term exclusively, and they cannot write, pen up their agreements accordingly. So these are the restrictions which are there when you are dealing with micro. I've taken a very, very macro view, not going too much into the case laws of it, because case laws pertaining to it, because I know by this time and at this hour you might also be like pretty exhausted, but and we also wanted to have an open house of any pending questions which you may have. So yeah, over to you, Sachin. Any questions in the chat box?
Thank you so much, ma'am. Excellent deliberation. I think all the questions we have taken on a real-time basis. So there is no pending case at this moment. Just hold on. I think some question is here. Ma'am, can you please once more summarize all the points of EL2? Is it possible to summarize all the points of EL2 now?
Well, try my best to. Of
course. Haan, mera beta.
Hopefully, I can. Yeah, I hope I don't miss out on anything, but just in case I do, please remind me. Okay, but I can tell you the slide numbers which you can revisit and see for yourself, but that's okay. Jokes apart. So EL2, if we say, if I summarize it again, EL2 is applicable to a non-resident e-commerce operator. So the intrinsic features here is that there should be a non-resident e-commerce operator, and the business should be supply of services and supply provision of services and supply of goods. Now, the government has brought about certain clarifications in the Finance Bill 2021, where it says that all this online, which says that even acceptance of a purchase order or placing a purchase order, all of these shall be included in the definition of ESS. तो अगर बहुत बेसिक बेसिक बात करें तो EL2 वहां पर ही लगता है जहां पर देयर इज अ Amazon US. Amazon India पे नहीं लगता है, Amazon US पे लगता है. सो इफ देयर इज अ नॉन रेजिडेंट हु इज ऑपरेटिंग इन इंडिया, यू नो व्हिच इज ऑपरेटिंग इन इंडिया, दे आर प्रोवाइडिंग एनी सर्विसेज और दे आर सेलिंग एनी गुड्स टू द इंडियन कस्टमर, देन उसके ऊपर इक्वलाइजेशन लेवी 2 लगता है. ये इज नॉन रेजिडेंट e-commerce operator की obligation है to pay that, to collect that EL2 and to pay to the government exchequer. EL2 is applicable on the entire gross receipt, which is the entire consideration. आप जितना commission ले रहे हो for facilitating उस पर नहीं होगा, पूरे पे होगा. Now the intent of the government is that आप या तो PE बना लो इंडिया में, अगर आप PE नहीं बनाओगे तो आप EL2 दे दो. So they just want to tap, they just don't want these companies to go scot-free. So that is the intent. Apart from EL2, there is an additional burden on an e-commerce operator in India, of a non-resident e-commerce operator in India. The second burden is ki if a resident is selling on the platform, using their platform, if a resident is selling to another resident in India, then TDS provision under section 194O shall apply. Uski bhi compliance jo hai e-commerce operator ko karni hai, 1% charge deduct karna hai. Even if the payment is directly received by that non-resident seller. Clear? Now the third tranche of this is that agar NR to NR transaction, like non-resident e-commerce operator facilitates a service which is provided by another non-resident to an Indian resident, then what happens, whether equalization 2 levy shall apply? The answer is yes, equalization levy 2 shall apply only in two specified circumstances, which are सेल ऑफ एडवर्टीजमेंट और सेल ऑफ डेटा. अगर ये दो सर्कमस्टांसेस नहीं है तो ई एल टू शैल नॉट अप्लाई इन अ एनआर टू एनआर सिचुएशन, एनआर टू एनआर ट्रांजेक्शन. थ्री एक्सक्लूजन आर देयर. ई एल वन अगर लगा रहे हैं तो ई एल टू नहीं लग सकता है. ओवरलैप नहीं हो सकता है, को एग्जिस्ट कर सकते हैं डिपेंडिंग अपॉन द थ्रेशहोल्ड्स. अगर 2 crore से नीचे टर्नओवर है तो ई एल टू नहीं लगेगा. और अगर आपकी पी बन गई है इंडिया में, आपने एक्सेप्ट कर लिया कि मैं 40% इनकम टैक्स दूंगा, तब आपके ऊपर ई एल टू नहीं लगता है. अदरवाइज ई एल टू ग्रॉस बेसिस पे लगेगा टू अ नॉन रेजिडेंट ई कॉमर्स ऑपरेटर. आई होप आई एम एबल टू समराइज इट इन लाइक
वेरी वेल समराइज. आई थिंक इट्स अ एक्सीलेंट समराइजेशन. सो आई फील दैट देयर इज नो क्वेश्चन लेफ्ट. And if there is any question, we can share your credentials so that the person can ask the question directly with you. And now it's time to a vote of thanks. So thank you so much, ma'am, for your excellent deliberation. And thank you, CASA, for organizing such a wonderful webinar. And friends, it's three-day webinar. And today we have concluded the first day webinar. And the remaining 2 days are also very important. So I request you all to please be there on time and enjoy the session. And thank you so much, ma'am. I feel that you have very well covered the equalization levy portion and the FEMA portion, that how to make the payment and whenever we make the payment, what are the caution should be taken care. And in case of any query, we'll definitely share the details so that the person can raise the query to you directly. And last but not the least, thank you so much to all the participants who have patiently here since 5 o'clock and making the webinar very interactive. Thank you so much to all. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, CASA. Thank you, Sachin ji. And thank you to all the participants for bearing with us for so long. Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks.